So hopefully, let me know, find out after the coup and so on, but hopefully everybody's here and no one's, you know, pulling sheetrock out of their home down in Houston. Can you imagine that? I mean, I just can't imagine taking a house from, you know, 8 feet down and taking everything out. You see these piles in the front yards, it's just, I don't know, it makes me cry. And two, you know, how expensive is that? It seems like it'd be cheaper to build a new house, but maybe not. You still have the foundation and the roof, so we'll see. So, compared to the other folks. So my complaints about the schedule and how it's wrecked are, you know, of course, minimal. But still, we're kind of going to play catch up a little bit. And so that's a bit stressful, but that's also why I'm videoing the lecture, so that if there's something that's really unclear, you can go back and review that to see. You know, if I say something and you're like, oh, I need to write that down, and you start to write it down, it's really almost impossible not to turn your ears off while you're writing. And so you really do miss quite a bit. You may think you're a great note taker. I thought I was. One summer I took a cell biology class. It was my only class. And I thought, this is the semester I'm going to record the lectures and rewrite my notes and all that stuff. And I would go right after class to the library for an hour. I could play it at double speed because the guy talked kind of slow. So I could go through like a 3-hour lecture in an hour and a half and recopy my notes. I couldn't believe how much I missed, you know. And not only that, but it kind of freed me up, because when I was taking notes and the fellow talked too fast, I could say tape, you know, in my notes. And I would send myself to the tape and know that, you know, I could go get that little phrase and not try to get it down verbatim. And so use that, because we're going to be putting these up as quickly as we can. Like I said, this is the first semester where I've had so many people who have already had the course that are just sitting in, kind of auditing the course to kind of refresh their memory. And so they're helping with the videos. So yay, thank you for the folks that are just sort of doing that at a selfless service. Since they're not having to cramp their hand and write down everything I've said, because they passed the course already, they're just here, and I'm really appreciative of them. So it's Will, yay, and Matthew in the back, and then your TAs, Nick and Vicencio. So good for them. Okay, so, you know, there's a lot of destruction down in Houston, and you know, the city hall down there, they had a fence that was destroyed, and so they had to get some contractors to come in and bid for the job. So a fellow from Huntsville went down, and he measured and so on, and he said, yeah, it's, you know, it's not that complicated. It'll be $500. So the city said, okay. So we need three bids. So then the guy from Conroe shows up, and he measures, you know, and things are a little more expensive in Conroe, so his expenses are higher. And so, you know, he offers $1,000 for the bid, and then this fellow comes down from Dallas, and he talks to the city official. He says, yeah. He says, I can do the job for $2,500. And the official says, you didn't even measure anything. And it's so much higher than all the other bids. And he goes, shh, shh. He says, $1,000 for you, $1,000 for me, and we get the guy from Huntsville to do it. So hopefully that's not what's going on. I want to cast this whole semester for you guys, and really your degree in chemistry. You know, I talked about it, you only being maybe the less than 2% of the whole SAM population that's in this course. That's amazing to think about, you know, that this degree is really difficult. And there are a lot of easier degrees, if you will. Now, every degree, if you get up into the senior level courses, kind of gets difficult, but then not as bad as chemistry, I'll admit that. But I want you to think about this. And I want you to have this sort of concept or phrase in your mind, okay? Because getting through chemistry will open doors for you. There's hundreds of jobs in chemistry. Every kind of analysis, you got environmental labs, petrochemical labs, pharmaceutical labs. Up in the Midwest, they've even got food labs, you know? They measure the flow of ketchup. You need a chemistry degree to talk about viscosity and measure the flow of ketchup, okay? Makeup, okay? There's a chemist in all of these places. And so you really have chosen a degree that's going to change your life. And so that's a phrase I would like you to think about. Chemistry changed my life. This degree in chemistry will change your life. But this course, PChem, is probably the most hated course in all of chemistry. I own it. Okay, that's why I say Peek Him for All. That's my online handle. Okay, because I think it's great. Because this is the course that changes your mind. This is when you hit that barrier and you're like, uh-oh. You know, I hacked my way through freshman, I hacked my way through organic. And, you know, quant was there, but... you know, it was somewhat tough in some places, but I hit a wall at Peek Him. And so, the thing, chemistry changed my life, but Peek Him changed my mind. Chemistry changed my life, but Peek Him changed my mind. What does that mean? It changes your mind about your self-assessment, what you can do. And it also changes your mind by making you an evidential person. We are not going to teach this course as if the wave function is an obviously known thing. It's not. Right? When we're talking about waves, it's bizarre, isn't it? What on earth are we talking about with these wave functions? It's like a guitar string vibrating. Okay? How does that have any connection to reality? And the answer is, I can't tell you that. All I can tell you is that it matches the data. All of the philosophical problems we talked about last time are still there. What does it mean? I don't know. Okay, that's fun to unpack. But in here, we're going to just look at the data, and we're going to see if we can measure spectra and then use wave thinking to match those spectra. Because billiard balls doesn't get it done. A billiard ball can have any energy, but a wave can't. A wave is quantized. And so that's what I mean by Peek Him changing your mind. It's changing the way you assess the world around you, and it's changing the way you assess your own abilities. So chemistry changed my mind, my life. Peek Him changed my mind. So let's dive in. This is the semester here. Hurricane Harvey blew a hole in the thing. So we're going to double up on the lectures today. And that's not a problem. Even if I speak fast, you've got the video. Okay. So a lot of times, I just want you to sit back and listen. Okay, this isn't a lot of stuff that you're going to have to repeat. That hands-on part, the learning by doing, is in the lab. And some of you have already experienced that yesterday. Doing the calculus, a nice review, you're like, oh yeah, I remember the integral. Oh yeah, I remember the derivative. And so hopefully you're remembering those things as we go along. So even though I say the quantum mechanical postulates are going to be on the internet video, we're going to do that just right now. We're going to go ahead and knock through that. So this is a whole chapter in the book called The Quantum Mechanical Postulates. And so what on earth is a postulate? Let's start from the basics of those words. It's just an assumption, right? To postulate, the verb form, is to suggest or assume the existence or fact or truth of something as a basis for reasoning. You know, the basis of all reasoning is assuming that truth exists and it can be known. Right? If you don't agree on that, then it doesn't do any good to argue about anything else. If you think you can't know truth, then what are you arguing for? So the existence of truth and its knowability is a postulate. It's an axiom. You can't go below that because you have to start there. And so with these quantum mechanical postulates, if they don't seem obvious to you, join the club. Okay, they're the baseline where we start. So we're going to start by saying, let's treat nature as a wave, and then let's see if that can match the evidence, okay? But this is a starting point. And so postulate number one is the state of a quantum mechanical system is completely specified by a wave function. It's just a function that's periodic, like a sine wave or a cosine. So we know about sines and cosines. Those are wave functions. So there's nothing magical about the term. It's just a wave function. And that the state of that quantum mechanical system can be specified by that. And so the probability of finding a particle in all space should be one. If I look everywhere, and I've got a particle somewhere, if I look everywhere, I'm going to find it. And so what's the probability of finding it if I look everywhere? It's one. Probabilities go from zero to one. And so if we integrate over all space, which would be in one dimension, negative infinity to positive infinity, then we're going to end up having a probability of finding that particle as one, and we're going to find it. Now, what is this? These are the wave functions, and that's another part of this puzzle. It's called the probability distribution. When you square the wave function, those negative pieces become positive, right? So squaring a negative number makes it positive. So we square that wave function, and that now becomes the probability distribution. Think carefully about the words. Probability distribution. It's distributing the probability of finding that particle over all space. And so if I integrate half of all space, what's the probability? 0.5. If I integrate a third of all space, I'll probably get a third probability for finding that particle. So it's the probability distribution. It's how that particle would be divided over all space. Now, how do you divide a particle? And that's where the philosophical manipulations come in. Okay, we're really not dividing that particle. We're saying, if I had a little BB gun and I could shoot through this box in different places, a third of the time, if I shot over here, I'd knock the particle out. And so it's a statistical distribution. So if I did 1,000 experiments, a third of the time I would see the particle over in a third of the box. Or half the time I'd see the particle in one half of the box. If I shot that little laser gun all over the box, I would get a particle every time. Someplace in that box, I'd knock the particle out. Now these wave functions have to be periodic, they have to be smooth, and so on. So there are some criterion for wave functions. It can't just be any function. And so these are the four criterion for a wave function. It can't be broken. Okay, think of a guitar string. That's not a very good guitar string. And this isn't either. So it needs to be continuous in its first derivative. So it has a point here. That's a continuous line, meaning it's connected from left to right, but it's got a kink in it. And so at that point, the slope is one value if I come at it from this direction, and it's a different value if I come at it from that direction. So at that kink, the slope is not defined. It's discontinuous. Okay. And so since we have to take the second derivative of our wave function, which we'll find out in a minute, we can't have a kink in our wave function. It has to be single value. So this one right here has three values, right? So that's not a valid wave function. And it has to be finite. So your wave function can't go to infinity in the middle. You can't have any asymptotes in the middle. So if your wave function satisfies these four criteria, then you could have a valid wave function. And then you would see if it matches experimental data. So that's the change your mind part. How would we know if we've got a good wave function? See if it matches the data that you get from a spectrometer. Now, we talked about normality or normalized wave functions. A normalized wave function is a wave function that matches that criterion, where when you square it and integrate over all space, it gives you that probability of one. That's called a normalized wave function. We also want our wave functions to be orthogonal. So if I have a quantized system, I don't want the ground state wave function to be used to construct one of the upper state wave functions. In other words, I need to have my system be in one state only. It can't be in a combination of states. In other words, thinking of a guitar string, you want your guitar string to play one tone. You don't want it to be a combination of tones. That'd be a really cool instrument, but a really, really bad quantum system to play a note and get a chord, okay, on one string. So this orthogonality is essentially saying that each state of the system will have just one wave function associated with it. When we look at this, if we take, say, a wave function for quantum state one and multiply it by a wave function of quantum state two and integrate that over all space, we get a zero. And in other words, it's saying if you tried to make a combination of these things and integrate it over all space, you would get zero. And so that's what this matrix here, you're going to see this matrix when you do your Excel project here in a couple of weeks, is you're going to take every wave function here and multiply it by every other wave function and integrate, and you're going to get these results. And these squares here are the results of those integrals that we get in Excel. And you see, 1 combined with 2 is 0. 1 combined with 3 is 0. 1 combined with 4 is 0. But yet, 1 combined with itself is 1. 2 combined with itself is 2. So this square here, this result of all these integrals, shows you the normality. So when 3 combined with itself, I get 1. But 3 combined with anything else, I get 0. So that's orthogonal and normal And so scientists are always lazy. They try to combine everything. So they call it orthonormal. Right? Because we don't want to write out two big words. We just want to combine it into one smaller word. So it's orthonormal wave functions. They're orthogonal to each other, but then when multiplied by themselves, they're normalized, and they give you this probability of one of finding that particle in all space. And so that's what we have. And not only that, they get tired of writing the integral sign and dx. And so they just use these little angle brackets. We have Paul Dirac to thank for that, and that's called Dirac notation. So this piece right here with the integral, minus infinity, positive infinity, and dx, and the wave functions has all been reduced to this right here. That's exactly the same thing. So you might want to write that down. So go ahead and take the time, if you don't have the notes printed off, write this right here, this top line. And then just write the first part of this second line here, and say those are the same thing. Same thing. What's that?
It just kind of clicked. Something's
gone
through the second
line. So these
time.
Little brackets, we're going to use these brackets the whole semester. And anytime you see those angle brackets, that's an integral. Okay? Because we're lazy. Could we not be lazy? Could I write out the integral? Yes, I could, but then you wouldn't know Dirac notation. Right, so this is the notation, so I want to teach you the notation. Those angle brackets, those sharp brackets, those are the notation for doing an integration over all space. And when the n is not equal to n prime, it's equal to zero, and so this is all in one statement. The orthonormal condition is this right here, this integral over all space of quantum number, a wave function with quantum number n going to some different quantum number or the same, is this delta, and that's the Kronecker delta. So I mean, this is ridiculously lazy to write this whole thing down, where you have to then define what delta is, and it's one when they're the same and zero when they're different. And essentially this piece right here in mathematical formulation gives you this whole matrix. This matrix goes to infinity, by the way. I mean, you can have an infinite number of quantum numbers. And so to write that table out is impossible because it goes to infinity. But you could say the same thing using math. And that's why we use math. We use mathematical formulations because that right there is infinite. N can go to infinity, and we can write that out on one line. Yes?
Just for clarification, my end. So if we know what, say, like the size are, if the size end up being the same, and we have to write it out in like the longer form of it, we're going to equal it out to one. Mm-hmm. If they're different, if we know the size are different, we have to expand it. We're going to equal it out to zero, correct?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. Yeah. And you may want to show that, like that may be a homework problem.
Right.
Show that psi one times psi three equals zero, and so then you would have a 1 inside, and we'll see what these wave functions are. So
right.
Let's look at them next. So here's just to show, I did these plots in Excel. Here's 1 times 1. So it's the same function times the same function, integrated over all space. And golly, the color is terrible. Okay, so there is a tiny light blue line. Trust me. Up here. I need to change the color on that. But this line goes here. As I integrate this times this, these two functions times each other, I'm integrating, and so I'm adding, integral's a sum, and so I'm just adding the area under that curve, and it's getting bigger and bigger and bigger, and when I get to all space, 100, okay, then the result is 1. That's pretty cool. Let's take one that has some negative regions. So I take this function and multiply by that function again, and I get this little tiny orange curve. Why is it so small? Well, because all of these are less than 1, and so I'm taking 0.1 and times 0.1. But this negative piece becomes positive. And so I've got three little bumps down here. And when I integrate those, it goes up really fast here where there's some non-zero stuff. And then it crosses zero. And so then there's really not much to add there. Then it gets bigger, faster again, and then it slows down. And then it gets bigger again and stops at the other end. So I've integrated over all space, which in our case is minus 100 to 100. result is one. So this is the plot of all of these little pieces up here, you know, that give you the ones. Yes.
So basically, you take the area basically under that.
Yeah, and so you're just adding it up, and you go to the next little spot, and you take all the area you had before, and you add the new area to it, and then you move forward, and that's numerical integration, and that's what we're going to do in Excel.
That equals 1, not 2?
It equals 1. Mm-hmm. And even though it's 3, it's quantum number 3 times quantum number 3, it's the wave function for each of those, multiplied by each other, and then integrated. That's what the angle brackets are, and the result is 1. So that's just showing graphically what we see up here. Let's look at the orthogonal parts. So here I have 1 and 2. So this is the wave function for 1. And you can see there's no nodes. This is a node in the middle, okay? And here's 2. It has one node here in the middle. So I take this blue times the purple, and I get this yellow. And because I have a positive part for wave function 1 and a negative part for wave function 2, this yellow part is negative, right? And then I integrate that over all space. Well, if I integrate over half of the space, it is non-zero. But if I keep integrating over all space, it comes back down to 0. And so 1 times 2 integrated over all space is 0. So this, again, just graphically showing you what we have with these different integrations. Now, postulate 2 is observables. Postulate 1 was about the probability distribution, normality of wave functions. Postulate 2 is now every experimental property has some quantum mechanical operator associated with it. And so we can sort of theoretically do the experiment on the wave function using mathematics. And so this is, again, part of the postulates. And so we haven't proven this, but we're going to try it, if you will. We kind of pretend in this course that we're going into this new territory as pioneers. You know, we're going to try this and see if it works, and we'll see that it does. It matches the spectroscopy that we get. So an experiment in the lab to measure a value is simulated in the theory by operating on the wave function. And so we'll have certain things that we can operate on. When I say operate, you're familiar with plus and minus, times and divide. But a derivative is also an operator. An integral is also an operator. Okay, so those things are operators too. Not just multiply and divide, but also take the derivative, take the integral. And so these are some observables that we have in nature, like momentum, kinetic energy, position, potential energy, total energy. And these are the mathematical formulas that we can use on a wave function to give us those observables. Isn't that cool? It's all been worked out for us. Now, we're not going to be able to answer why this is the momentum operator. These are the postulates. These are our starting points. If that's not satisfactory to you, go into experimental physics. Keep pulling the thread, okay? But we got to start somewhere, and in this course, these are the postulates that we're going to start with. The main one that we're going to use, the main two, is the total energy operator, and this has the designation H. It's named after Hamilton, so it's the Hamiltonian. And X, that's the position operator, and we're going to use that one to simulate light. So we're going to use X, and we're going to use this thing here. And you'll see this a bunch, so don't worry about scribbling it down. It's in the notes, it's on the lecture, and we're going to use it a bunch, okay? Especially in lab. So this one is kind of confusing because of the words, eigenvalues, and so on. The eigenvalue problem really stems from using matrices to solve these problems. Why do this problem for one quantum state? Why not do it for 15, like we'll do in the lab? And so when you're dealing with that, matrix mathematics really helps. Now, raise your hand, don't go yet, raise your hand if you have ever used matrix multiplication. So on the count of three, don't look around, just raise your hand. I want to see instantaneously who's done matrix mathematics. Oh, raise your hand.
On computer or on paper?
I'd say either. So either on paper in high school algebra 2 or something, or on the computer. Okay, so most everybody. But that doesn't mean that I'm going to assume you remember it. Okay? But you've at least thought about it. Okay? And so we're going to do that in Excel. It's really amazing. You'll do 225 integrals in Excel by hitting Control Shift Enter. So isn't that great? You know, in lab, the first week of lab, you're going to do two or three integrals on three sheets of paper. Okay? But 225? Come on. You know? So you can add up. You will do more integrals in this class than you did in calculus. You know? But you only do two or three by hand. And the rest, you'll hit Control Shift. And it'll be great. Yeah. And so these eigenvalues are the results, these energies. You can see the eigenvalues for the orthonormal matrix are the normalized values. For the energy operator, the orthonormal values or the eigenvalues will be the energies. Okay. And so this is our expectation value. If we put the Hamiltonian in here and do this integral on top, this down here, if our wave functions are normalized, becomes 1. Look here, you got the wave function times itself, integrated over all space. So that's just saying if I don't have normalized wave functions, then this will correct for it. If I do, this is 1. So really, we just have the Hamiltonian operating on the wave function and left multiplied by another version of that wave function and integrated over all space. And if it's the Hamiltonian, then this is the expected energy. No, this is just in general. This is written in general. So if it's just A, let's say the expected value of A. But this, you put the operator in here, and it would be the energy. If it's the Hamiltonian, it's the expected energy. If it's X, then it's the expected position. Okay. If it's the momentum operator, then it's the expected momentum. So it's an average value for those wave functions. So what we're doing is we're getting the energies for state 1, energies for state 2, and so we could write out this difference in energy between two energy levels using wave functions and Dirac notation. So this delta E is the energy of state 2 minus the energy of state 1. And you've seen this before, even in organic, when they talk like a bond dissociation energy, you have how much energy it takes to rip a chlorine off of an organic molecule. That would be state 2, where the chlorine is gone. State 1 would be the ground state of that molecule. So that's delta E. Well, there's a wave function associated with the molecule minus the chlorine. And there's a wave function associated with the molecule with chlorine. And you get that from the wave functions, the Hamiltonian. So all of those things have quantum mechanics all buried down in there. So then time dependence, we won't deal with time dependence, but it's in this chapter. So I just want to talk about, even if it looks like the system is static, it's not. So it's also oscillating in time. And what's interesting too, we confuse you maybe with the talk about wave functions and saying that they represent reality, because when we do experiments, the mathematics that use wave functions matches experiment. What about imaginary numbers? Who understands those? Raise your hand. You understand imaginary numbers? You too. Now, you may understand how to use them, but what is it?
Square root of a negative number.
Yeah, but that's a functional definition. What is it?
Basically, if you can't
remember that, can't
get to the other side of the wall by walking through, you go around it using imaginary numbers.
Yeah, they're useful mathematical formulism, but what are they?
Conceptually see what they're getting at behind it, but I can't really define it.
Yeah, exactly. What does it mean? And here we have imaginary time. This is going to be the derivative with respect to time, and it's going to be Euler's relationship, which has an imaginary part to it. And then we also have this imaginary I built into this time operator. And so, yeah, what does that mean? Okay, but yet we were taught imaginary numbers. It's the square root of minus 1, and we use it, and it's useful. But if you've got a good answer for what it means, like what is I, like beyond its just functional definition, then tell me. Okay, so we're comfortable with that just from our mathematical, you know, upbringing. become comfortable with wave functions too. So don't get overly stressed about what's actually shaking in a wave function. Okay? Okay? We can treat it as a functional use, just like we treat imaginary numbers being the square root of negative 1. There may be more to the wave function than that, but there doesn't have to be, is all I'm saying. So those are the quantum mechanical postulates. I know that it's kind of like the deep end of the pool. It's okay. But we're going to bring the floaties out here pretty soon. You can survive. Let's start playing around with the wave functions. Specifically the Schrodinger equation. And then we'll talk about this normalization. We'll actually show a bit of the calculus. It's not so much the calculus that I want to review. It's the evaluation of the function. Because that's the skill, I think, that people lack. You might get to a result and not know you're done. Right? You just keep doing things and canceling things, and you don't really know when you're done. And so knowing when you're done is a real trick in science. I remember taking thermodynamics from Glenn Evans in graduate school, and he would fill the board with math. And he's doing partial differentials and all of these things, and he gets there and he goes, aha! And I looked at it and I was like, what is aha? You know. So I raised my hand and I said, why wasn't this step aha? You know, he's going along and gets to this step and all of a sudden, aha. And he goes, we can't measure that, but we can measure this. And so he was going to say aha when he got to something that he could evaluate or he could measure. And so whenever you get through with those mathematics, and you're going along, you're like, okay, now I'm to a point where I can actually make some judgments, and I can evaluate this function. So this is all temperature dependent too. Let me just say a quick thing about Boltzmann. We wouldn't have quantum mechanics without Boltzmann. And Boltzmann really wasn't aiming at quantum mechanics. He was trying to understand the kinetic theory of gases and the velocity of gases. And so he came up with this Boltzmann distribution here in 1877, just sort of modeling the thermal equilibrium of gas molecules. And his paper was really successful. It helped them understand heat flow in a gas and convective currents and so on like that, and equal thermal equilibrium, essentially. And Planck knew that that would fix the problem, but the thing that Boltzmann used was that gases had essentially discrete energy packets that they could use. And it really wasn't, I guess, a big part of his theory, but Planck used it to describe the black body radiator. And so this sort of pulled Boltzmann's distribution into quantum mechanics and said, nature is quantized. And so we have the probability of being in a particular energy level based upon Boltzmann's distribution, and it's temperature dependent. So this is the thermal temperature of the system. This is the gas constant, R. And this is the energy of the various energy levels. And this is the sum of all the populated energy levels, so that's in the denominator. And this is the energy of a particular energy level, and so this would be the probability of being in that level. Okay. Now, I had, in previous years, a little more time, and so we would all traipse out into the stairwell, and I would put you on the stairs based upon a Boltzmann distribution. If those stairs were 100 joules per mole apart, and we were at room temperature, then there would be three people on the ground floor and the next five stairs. So there'd be three molecules, people, on the first six places. And then two all the way up to about stair number 17. And then all the way up to the top of the first floor stairwell, there'd be one person. And so why is that? I mean, that's because we're at room temperature and it's pretty hot and those stairs are pretty small. So it doesn't take much for you to hop up a stair or hop down a stair. And you're all going to be changing places over time, but on average, the system's going to have a particular energy that corresponds to room temperature. And it's also very difficult to study that kind of system because there's molecules in all those energy levels. So what do we like to do in science? We like to simplify things, and so we would cool it down. And if I put you in liquid nitrogen, okay, then everybody would start to lose energy to the liquid nitrogen and cool down. And in 77 Kelvin, there would be 8 students on the ground floor, 7, 6, 5, 4, 4, 3, 3, 2, 2, 2, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1. And there'd be nobody on stair 18 or above. So that would be at the liquid nitrogen temperature. And if I cooled you down to like 5 Kelvin, everybody would be on the ground floor and one student on the first stair. Okay. And so that would be a very simple system to study. So now you see why chemists and physicists really want to cool their systems down, because it simplifies the spectra. And we can know that using Boltzmann distribution. So we've confirmed this a million times. Now, dealing with waves and these quantized energy states, we have Erwin Schrödinger. And so he's the one that worked out the math for these energy problems and using wave functions and the eigenvalue, eigenvector problem. And here's his equation. You'll see this all over the place. In fact, it's in the back of one of Weird Al Yankovic's videos. Okay. Yeah. The white and nerdy video. It's also in a lot of cartoons, like Six Chicks. They had a little cartoon in the paper, and it was some kind of equation was part of their storyline, and it was the Schrödinger equation. It's like, So now you'll see it everywhere, especially this part. And so this is his equation. You see H operating on the wave function is equal to E, which is a constant, times that wave function. So psi are the wave functions, E are the energy levels. H is the Hamiltonian operator, the total energy operator. And this H bar is, again, lazy, lazy, lazy. H bar is H over 2 pi. And so, you know, you think about all the math that these people were doing by hand, all these shortcuts. You see H bar, and they just got tired of writing divide by 2 pi. Yeah. And so in cyclical or wave type systems, you have up divided by 2 pi all the time. And so when you see H bar, don't think it's just Planck's constant. It's Planck's constant divided by 2 pi. And M is the mass of the particle. And V is the potential energy condition. And this is an upside down delta with a half. Okay? And it's squared. But it's really not anything squared, it's the second derivative operator. So, you know, deltas change, right? You typically think about delta. Of course, if you're an organic chemist, it's heat, so forget about that. Okay. We talk about delta being change. Well, this is an upside down delta showing you it's the second derivative operator. And so it's the second derivative with respect to all your spatial coordinates. So sometimes they do a shorthand and just call it tau, but in our cases it would be x, y, and z. Or if you're in a spherical system, it'd be spherical polar coordinates of r, the radius, theta, so the sort of the latitude and longitude, phi. So r theta phi could be here, r theta phi, or x, y, z, or just lumping it all into one overall coordinate, tau. So that's the pieces of Schrödinger's equation. So that h on the top shows you that it's an operator. You cannot do this. Okay, this will get you an F in the course. You can't just cancel the size and say H equals E. We're done. Because it's not just H times psi, it's operating on it. That's what the hat is. It's taking the second derivative of psi. Okay, so that was easy. You know, it's kind of like find X. Here it is. But what is the second derivative? You know what derivatives are. What's the first derivative? It's just in mathematical terms. If I take the first derivative, what am I learning about the curve?
The
slope. So if I take the first derivative of the slope function, I get the slope of the slope. So I get how the slope is changing, and we call that curvature. So the second derivative is the curvature of the wave function. And I love that term. Sometimes terms aren't very clear in their name, like eigenvalue, eigenfunction. Okay, that doesn't really mean much to me, you know. But curvature means a lot. So this is telling me that curvature is related to energy. So if I have a wave function that's curving a lot, it's a high energy. Everybody let that soak in. If I have a wave function that's curving a lot, it's high energy. If I have a wave function that's not curving, it's low energy. how do I know if a wave function's curving a lot? Remember, it can't go to infinity, and it can't just curve up here all the time. It's going to cross zero a bunch. And so a curvy wave function has a lot of nodes. A curvy wave function crosses zero a bunch of times, and those nodes indicate your curvature. And so you're going to be able to say that a wave function with a lot of nodes is high energy. A wave function with no nodes is going to be the lowest energy. Okay, so this is a weird function because something's operating on the wave function, and after it operates on the wave function, I have a constant out front, and I have that wave function back. And so these are specific functions that will work with this. Is the natural log of x going to remain after I take the derivative twice? No, but what about cosine x? If I take the derivative of cosine, what do I get? Sine. If I take the derivative of sine, I get cosine back, negative cosine. So after taking the derivative twice, I get cosine back. What about sine? If I start with sine, I take the first derivative, cosine, I take the second derivative, I get sine back. So this is beautiful. Cosine and sine work with the Schrodinger equation. And so we're going to use sine as our wave function for the particle in a box. Yes?
But when the sign changes, it's still going to be the same.
Yeah, well, it comes out front, and that's where we get this constant out front. And so things are going to come out of that sine function and become our energies. It's really cool. So this works so well that Dirac made this bold statement. He says, the underlying laws for all of chemistry are known. This mathematics works so well, we can predict reaction rates, we can predict equilibrium constants, we can predict all the spectral properties of chemicals. It works that well. I haven't proven it to you, but this is where we're going. And so it's amazing. The problem is that these equations are so long, and when you get into two electrons, too complex to do analytically, we have to do it numerically, which means we need to use a computer. And so that's why we've built all of these huge array of supercomputers. We know the functions, but the systems are enormous. We've talked about the probability density. We've talked a little bit about imaginary numbers, but I need to make one point, and that is when we're multiplying this wave function by itself, it's not just straight multiplication. There's this little star here. That star is not indicating multiplication. That star is indicating the complex conjugate. And it doesn't matter for our sine wave function, but it does when we're dealing with rotation and using e to the x. So for rotation, our wave function is e to the im phi, or negative im phi, and that's the imaginary I. M is the quantum number in this case, and phi is the rotation angle. And so the complex conjugate, everywhere there's an I change the sign. And so that's really handy because then the imaginary parts go away when I multiply them. So if I take the complex conjugate and multiply by the wave function, I end up with this e to the im phi minus im phi in the exponent, and the i's go away. They cancel out. And so taking the complex conjugate is critical to get rid of the imaginary part of the wave function. You're not going to have to use that, but I'm just pointing out that this little star here, there may be one case, this case right here in the notes, where you do use that. So let's look at this wave function now. Here's our wave function for a particle in a one-dimensional box. Now, the one we're going to use in lab is slightly different, and that's on purpose. I didn't want it to be exactly like the notes, okay, so that you have to think your way through a problem. But it's also important, too, because I want our wave function to be centered on zero, and this one starts at zero. This one goes from zero to L. And in the labs, I wanted your wave function to go from minus L over 2 to plus L over 2. So I just shifted the wave function back a half a period. And what that does is it allows us to see the symmetry. Because we're going to deal with symmetry in the class, and I want the wave function to reveal that symmetry. But you could also have a particle in a two-dimensional box. So you could have a length 1 and a length 2, and this is a common wave function. You have x and y now, and you have two quantum numbers. You can have a particle on a ring, and that's that imaginary wave function I was talking about. Now, Euler's relationship would take this and break it into a real part, which was the cosine phi and the I minus I sine phi, or vice versa. And that, so that's also sines and cosines inside of e to the I and phi. And then the vibrational motion, harmonic oscillator. You remember that in physics, the pendulum problem, okay, or mass on a spring. This is the wave function for that. And in fact, our vibrational, like the carbon or the chlorine hydrogen in HCl, that hydrogen is just vibrating away from that chlorine. It's almost like the chlorine doesn't even move because the hydrogen is so light. And so this is a very good wave function to use for that hydrogen vibrating against that chlorine. And it's one-dimensional. So these are, this one's one-dimensional, this one's one-dimensional, and this one's one-dimensional. So we could do all this top one and these bottom two very easily by hand. And sometimes people assign a two-dimensional one to do by hand. But that's in essentially the third semester calculus, the multivariable calculus, which many people haven't had. So let's walk through this real quick. I'm going to do this in stepwise manner so that you can follow along. Turn the grids off. Okay. Okay. So what we'd like to do is basically verify this normalization constant, the square root of 2 over L. And so we have this wave function here, and I've put an n in front of it and just essentially said, what is that n? What is that normalization constant? And so this is the integral, and the reason I do this is to show you how to evaluate the function. And so we have this sine squared, the wave function times itself, integrated from 0 to L. Now, why would I do this trigonometric substitution? Well, I'm trying to integrate something that's sine squared. I want to reduce that power. And so when you're looking at a problem, you're like, gee whiz, sine squared. I know the integral of sine, but I don't know the integral of sine squared. Okay? I know the integral of cosine, but I don't know sine squared off the top of my head. But I look up a trigonometric substitution or identity and drop that power from sine squared down to cosine. And so I do this substitution. And now I have two pieces, and I can take the integral of the first piece and the integral of the second piece. So I essentially distribute that integration through, and so I've got the integral of this 1/2 dx minus the integral of this cosine 2n pi x over L. The first one is very easy. What's the integral of dx? The easiest integral we've ever do. It's x, right? And so then I have x over 2 evaluated at L and subtracting this x over 2 evaluated with 0. And then I have minus 1/2 sine x because, again, the integral of cosine was sine. Okay, and these pieces are supposed to come out front. I fixed this, and I don't know why it's not when I downloaded it again. This, the inverse of this 2n pi over L would be out in front of the sine. And then I evaluate that at L and 0. And so the main point I want to show is that I've got the L over 2 here, minus the 0 over 2. And then I have this sine of 0. That's easy, right? Sine of 0 is 0. But this is the one that I want you to think about. What is the sine of 2n pi L over L? So the L over L's cancel. What's the sine of 2n pi? N can be any number up to infinity.
Zero.
How do you know it's zero? What'd you say?
The sine of a whole number integer.
Whole number, yeah. So that's emphasizing that quantum numbers are whole numbers, right? They're integers. They go from 0 or 1 all the way up to infinity, but they're not 1.5. You know, if it was a fraction, like 1.5 times pi, this wouldn't be zero. But because it's every time sine crosses pi, it's zero. So this is zero pi, two pi, three pi. And so this piece is zero as well. And we just have L over 2 equals 1 over e squared. And so that's how we got this piece up front, this square root of 2 over L. That ensures that when I square this function and integrate over all space, the integral is 1. And so we call it the normalization constant, because that's the normalization condition. Okay, we're out of time. The next slide is very similar, and it's the Schrodinger equation. So we actually solve for the energies in this slide. So go through this, and you can do this in your notebook if you will write out text in between the lines. So if you need to put some of this stuff in your notebook, that's okay. Don't just copy it from the notes. That won't give you credit. But if you're analyzing these steps and sort of talking your way through it, that's golden. That's study, right? And so that's valid. Especially since we're kind of on an accelerated schedule, I would encourage you to do that with this one, for the Schrodinger equation. See you next time.